It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Simarjeet Saini. Professor Saini joined University of Waterloo in September 2007 as an assistant professor. He did his BTEC honors from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in 1996 and his doctorate from University of Maryland, College Park in 2001 under the guidance of Professor Mario Daguenas, a very well-known researcher. His PhD thesis was on the design and development of a new platform technology, monolithic integration of photonic devices called passive-active resonant coupler. The resulting technology led to the foundation of a startup company, Covega Corporation in Jesup, MD, Maryland. Professor Saini worked as a lead optoelectronics device engineer at Covega from December 2000 to December 2004 and as lead applications engineer from October 2005 to September 2007. He led the design and development of Covega's single angle facet chips, semiconductor optical amplifiers, and high power lasers. In August 2004, Professor Saini co-founded a startup company called Alternate Communications, which worked on Ethernet-based metro area networks with less than 5 millisecond restoration time using intelligence in the optical domain. He also served as a postdoc fellow from October 2004 to 2005 in Professor Daguenas' lab at the University of Maryland, where he worked on biochemical sensors and optical packet routing. Professor Saini has been granted 5 US patents and has 5 more in various stages of application. 3 of the patents have already been commercialized. He has co-authored over 20 journal papers and 40 conference presentations. He was granted the US Army Lab Research Fellowship from 1996-1998, a Distinguished Graduate Research Assistantship from University of Maryland from 1999 to 2000, and an PIE Educational Scholarship in 1999. Besides that, he was a part of a team comprising of undergraduate students in IIT Kharagpur, which received IEEE Vincent Benedict Award in 1995 for building a smart library. So with this introduction, I invite Professor Saini to deliver his invited talk this session. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor Saini. It's a real pleasure to be here. So today I'll talk about some of the work we are doing in University of Waterloo on silicon nanowire optical waveguides, which we call SNOW, and see some of their novel structures for computing. This work is actually a collaboration between two universities, between Professor Anandram from University of Washington, and is done by graduate students, which are mainly housed in University of Waterloo in supervision positions. Dharmashri, she does mainly the bandgap structure calculations that we're talking about today. Mohammad Reza, he does mainly the electromagnetic calculations and the invention of the SNOW waveguide. And Anita does work on silicon nanowire photodetectors. This part of the work I won't be talking about today. This work is also sponsored by DALSA Corporation over a 5-year funding through Ontario Centers of Excellence and Federal NSERC grant in Canada. The outline of our talk, I'll basically start with the motivation of why we are interested in silicon nanowires, what interesting properties. We start both from theoretical and experimental point of view. Then we go into this nanowire regimes and how they can start to create a very interesting optoelectronic logic devices. Discuss some of the silicon nanowire bandgap simulations we have been doing in our group. And then describe this new patent pending silicon nanowire optical waveguide we have invented recently, which allows us to achieve high conventional kind of optical confinement even in the nanowire regime. If time permits, I'll describe the optical logic gates. I'm not sure I'll be able to go through that, but then and then conclude the talk. Let's look at the motivation. When you go to nanoscale, when you start confining the carriers in a silicon in two dimensions, this starts to bring various new physical effects. Some of these effects I'll describe through my talk. These quantum effects, these new physical effects, basically based on the band gap engineering which happens in the nanoscale region, provides new possibilities for various optical optoelectronic devices including optical computing applications and logic gates. The main reason this happens is because of the direct band gap nature of silicon nanowires, and not only that, this direct band gap can be controlled, can be made direct or indirect depending on the strain you apply on these nanowires. The other advantage of silicon nanowires is that it has a great potential to integrate it with the conventional silicon CMOS technology. So in principle, we can start thinking of using conventional CMOS technology, using conventional CMOS circuitry to control these optoelectronic devices built with these silicon nanowires. There have been reports recently from the last 5 years where very thin nanowires of diameters up to 3 nanometers have been possible using the standard top-down approach methods which are compatible with the silicon CMOS technology. For example, this is a work which was done in Harvard University. This is basically what they have done is they have created silicon islands, and in between them they have grown a silicon nanowire using a vapor liquid surface methodology. This is basically a bottom-up approach. You grow the silicon nanowire by deposition between these two islands of silicon. In another work done in Singapore, they have created silicon nanowires by taking an SOI vapor and then etching this SOI vapor, oxidizing it, and etching the oxide here again, and then repeating this process to achieve very, very narrow, up to 3 nanometer diameter silicon nanowires. So this technology of achieving silicon nanowires is available today. It may be difficult, but it's available today, which makes it quite interesting to see whether we can start using it for optoelectronic devices or integrate it with other electronic circuits. The various advantages which silicon nanowire achieve are, the first one is high surface to volume ratio compared to above silicon. This actually can allow for better electrostatic control now, because you can do electrostatic control from 3 dimensions, which allows you to actually do band gap engineering of the silicon nanowire just by electrostatics. I won't be talking about this part of our work today, but other advantage of high surface to volume ratio can be used in biochemical sensors, because it can increase the sensitivity of the sensors because of the interaction of the optical wave with the material, biomaterial, sitting outside the nanowire. Again, I won't be talking about that part of the work today. Because of its small size, it also is much lower power consumption, and because of the quantum effects which happen here, we can actually achieve direct band gap semiconductor within a nanowire, and not only that, you can change this direct band gap to indirect by application of a cross-gate strain. I'll show some of the simulation work in that region. If we can change this direct to indirect band gap, then we can also change the optical properties of these nanowires, including the absorption change, the dielectric permittivity change, and we can start thinking of making optical logic gates or optomechanical gates based on these nanowires. And the main advantage and the processes we have been following in our lab is a top-down approach to try to make them as CMOS compatible as possible. So in future, we can think of start integrating electronic structures to it. So the project basically has these different research goals. We are looking at it from a very fundamental point of view, fundamental science point of view, and seeing whether we can observe both theoretically and experimentally changes in optical properties in the nano regime. The optical properties we are looking at include optical absorption, the group index, the group velocity dispersion, various polarization effects, and chiralities within these silicon nanowires, the nonlinear effects like Raman scattering, two-strong absorption, and Quark effects. And then decide from based on these fundamental measurements, where does it make sense to go to nano in the photonics region? Can we really make use of nano scales within the photonics region and see if we can create an integration platform where we can use the properties of the nano world while keeping the advantages of of the microgrid, like higher confinement factors, ease of coupling in and out. And basically the integration platform we have been able to achieve is the slow wave drive which I described today, which is basically arrays of vertical nano wires, and we show that they can act like very good optical wave drives and can achieve our goals of using enhanced optical properties of nano wires while keeping the confinement of conventional wave drives. The other part of the project includes nano wire silicon photodetectors. This part I won't touch on the talk at all today. Let's take a look at the silicon nanowire simulations we have been doing. The methodology we have followed for doing the simulations include basically looking at both the 110 orientations and the 100 orientations. The silicon nanowires, the silicon atoms are terminated with hydrogen because this creates the most stable silicon nanowire. In the first step, what we do is the diameters we have looked at so far vary from 1.7 to 3 nanometers, sub-nanometer region, where they become direct band gap. In the first step, we do the structure minimization, and we are looking at two different methodologies, including molecular dynamics and density functional theory, to take this arrangement of atoms and then minimize the energy to see how the atoms will stabilize within the silicon nanowire. We have been using both our own codes and some commercially available codes these are free softwares available, shareware softwares available to look at the structure minimization. We can calculate the band structure using the semi-empirical light finding approximation, and we use the transverse parameters for these particles within the silicon nanowire. What happens in silicon nanowires is that once the diameter becomes smaller than 10 nanometers, the material starts to become direct band gap. This direct band gap can become an essential property in silicon photonics. The reason of this direct band gap can be observed by looking at these isosurfaces of the conduction band. In a bulk silicon, you have these six different valleys which lie away from the brilliant center. Once we start confining these confining the silicon in two dimensions, in x and y dimensions, what happens is that these valleys over here, they start folding into the brilliant center, whereas the unconfined valleys, the valleys in the unconfined direction remain at roughly the same place. What is not shown here is the balanced band isosurface, which lies, which is almost a sphere and lies at the center of the brilliant structure. Because of this mismatch of the isosurfaces, in a bulk silicon material, this becomes indirect, but because these isosurfaces have folded into the brilliant center, these, in a silicon nanowire, it starts to become a direct band gap by the interaction of the valence band with this delta fold valence. Just to take as an example, this is the band gap calculation of the conduction and the valence band. For a silicon nanowire, 2.2 nanometers, I believe this is 100 orientation. And what we can see is that these isosurfaces create four degenerate wet bands around this region, and basically the direct band gap interaction is observed from this L band as opposed to this H band over here. The material becomes, you will see, direct band gap in this case. Further, if we apply strain to these nanowires, as we change from compressive to tensile strain, three important features are observed. The first feature is that as the strain is changed, as we put tensile strain, there is a huge change in band gap. So I can change the absorption properties, I can change the peak value of the absorption, but then just applying strain, just applying the tensile strain, stretching the nanowire slightly, and the band gap changes as large as 130 electron volts. Further, when I apply compressive strain for this nanowire, the diameter is 1.7 nanometers, at this point over here, If this region, the nanowire, is direct contact, then this region, the nanowire, becomes in direct contact. The H band starts to come below the L band, and the nanowire becomes direct contact. Because of this change in direct or indirect transition, there is a large change in electronic effective mass and density, effective density of state also. This can allow us to make very interesting optomechanical gates or switches, for example. I can have a high absorption region with a direct band gap, apply strain and change it to an indirect band gap and change the optical properties completely. We have still not calculated the optical absorption yet, but we have reached to a point where it should be done in a week or so. If you change, look at the different diameters, very interesting thing is observed. One, as I go to different diameters, from a lower diameter to higher diameter, the slope in the tensile region, the slope change of the band gap in the tensile region does not change. In fact, roughly remains the same as I change the tensile strain. The other thing which happens is that the strain which is required to change this nanowire from indirect to direct starts to become less. So for thicker nanowires, the strain required is actually smaller than for thinner nanowires. We haven't been able to go above 3.1 nanometers so far because of computing problems, because the grid size just becomes too large and it takes almost a week to start to calculate. Even for 3.1 nanometers to do the band gap structure is taking us a week. Beyond that, our computing resources have started to create problems right now. The reason why this change happens is that as you go from unstrained to compressive strain, the H band starts to come below and the L band starts to move up. And hence, after some compressive strain, the H band starts to dominate and the nanowire starts to become indirect. If you look at the effective mass and density of states, they have a huge change between the direct and the indirect band gap region. A huge change over here. This kind of changes we can measure experimentally can allow us to make very good optical, optomechanical switches with these nanowires. These nanowires also observe very interesting optical semi-isotropy. Different groups have shown that the PL intensity and the photocurrent generated by silicon nanowires depends on the polarization of the electric field. If the polarization of the electric input electric field is along the length of the nanowires, you get the maximum anisotropy. You get the maximum intensity, you get the maximum absorption. And the anisotropy is greater than 8%, depending on the various nanowires, can become quite large.
There is more absorption for light, which is polarized in this direction.
This is quite interesting, and we have a target. So this over here is the calculation of optical dipole matrix elements, which are required to calculate absorption. We have been able to achieve up to this point so far yet. And it actually, if you look at the scale is quite different in these cases. For this case, the electric field is polarized along the Z direction, and you see that maximum optical dipole matrix happens at the center of the Bayesian zone, whereas the electric field is polarized along x and y direction, the optical dipole moment matrix starts to decrease efficiently and starts to move away from the Bayesian center. The optical absorption is directly proportional to this optical moment matrix, which suggests that the optical absorption in this polarization of light must be quite good compared to these polarizations. So you would expect that these nanowires or cylinders, you would expect that both the X and the Y polarization should be the same because of the symmetry, but because these are terminated with hydrogen atoms, there is some residual strain which happens in these nanowires when the energy minimization happens on the surfaces, and thus there is a break in the symmetry in X and Y direction, depending on how you put the hydrogen bond, which is shown in the simulation over here. This optical anisotropy you can understand by looking at the conduction. conduction band, and you can see that this conduction band elements, the optical dipole elements, are quite asymmetric in the x and the y, in the x and the z directions. And because of that, the rate of the emission or the absorption is proportional to that overlap integral. We create a high optical anisotropy. Further, this optical anisotropy can be changed with spin. When we apply this compression, the 1% compression, where this nanowire becomes indirect, you can see that the balance band starts to split up, and thus the optical absorption should change appreciably, which you would expect anyway because this becomes indirect bandgap region. So by using this, we can change the optical properties within the silicon band 1. But because of this anisotropy, there is a problem with the bus. If I take this nanowire and I try to guide light through it, I cannot put the electric field along the length of the nanowire. If I try to propagate the electric field, if I try to propagate an optical wave through the nanowire, say like an optical fiber, except in the nanowire region, my electric field has to be transverse to the direction of propagation. So this basically means that if I want to use this higher value of absorption which I can expect in a silicon nanowire, after shine light from the top of the nanowire, I cannot propagate it along the length of the nanowire, and I cannot use the length to increase my optical problem. So if you take a look at these silicon nanowires, if you take a look at from the material point of view, they provide quite interesting, attractive features which we have seen in accumulation. One, that they become direct band gap, which increases the absorption, especially if the electric field is polarized along the length of the nanowire. We can change this, we can optomechanically switch this property and thus change the absorption by applying strain. And there have been other reports where experimentally it has been measured that there is three orders higher spontaneous Raman scattering, the non-linear Raman scattering in silicon nanowires when the diameter is less than 30 nanometers, and further field stimulated emission has been demonstrated in silicon nanowires by other groups. So we can start to think of making optical devices based on these interesting properties. But in order to be able to achieve optical properties, not only the material properties have to improve, but also we have to make sure that these nanowires are able to guide light to them, or are able to capture the light incident of them. So what happens, like what would be the optical guiding property of silicon nanowires? And that's where the problem comes. If I just take a silicon nanowire, and I try to guide light through it, say I take an optical fiber, same principle, except now I have gone to, instead of the silica, we have silicon, and I have gone to a very narrow diameter. If you look at the optical confinement factor, that is how much of the optical power is confined within the core of the silicon region, as the diameter of the silicon region decreases, the optical confinement starts to decrease appreciably. The core is not well confined. Even if I increase the material properties, the optical interaction with the carrier starts to decrease, and hence the device properties do not change. Actually perfect. So people have shown spontaneous emission, people have shown even stimulated Raman gain. The material property itself is quite large, but the device properties are very, very poor compared to conventional power data. If we especially go to 100 nanometers or less than that, the confinement factor is less than 0.1%. It's almost 0%. There's hardly any light which is confined in that. So we started to take a look at how does this light would interact with a silicon nanowire. We were interested in taking the polarization of the electric field should be along the length of the nanowire. So we were interested in that input polarization. We said, okay, let's take a look at what happens if we go to the nanowire region to see if we can find a solution to this problem. So the problem is basically this. We have a silicon nanowire coming out of the core. We're changing its diameter. The incident phase is hitting the silicon nanowire over here, and we look at when the electric field is polarized along the length, the z direction, or the magnetic field is polarized along the z direction, what happens to the wave as it propagates through this nanowire region. And we see some very interesting properties. This is the amplitude of the electric field plotted as we change the diameter of the nanowire from a conventional silicon photonic waveguide dimension of around 400 to 600 nanometers to the nanowire region of around 20 nanometers. One thing you have to keep in mind is that scales are quite different in each of these figures. So the red in this figure does not mean it is not equal to the red in this figure, but two is still not that bigger out of way to make all these figures on the same scale. If you take a look at these larger nanowires, basically what you're seeing is the plane waves are sitting in, it is exciting the different modes, there is interference happening between these modes, a multi-mode interference effect, and you start to see maximums and minimums depending on how the interference happens. If I make this even larger, I will clearly see the visiting gravity modes because of those interference effects, and the light will start to circulate in a certain cavity, which is what, how the microwave cavities work. Once I start going to smaller dimensions, if you look at the scale over here, the scale difference is quite small. Basically, the electric field is almost passing through the nanowire and is not being perturbed by the nanowire very much. If you look at the scale, this only changes from 1.02 to 1.03 or 1.04. Very, very little change happens with the electric field. This is further seen if you look at the phase front of this electric field. If I take a look at the wider nanowires or wider waveguide regions, the phase gets distorted as you would expect. This is how the photonic band gap crystals work. You distort the phase, you lift the phase, create a distorted phase front, and then you let it interfere with the band gap region for it to interfere and then guide within that gap region. However, if you start looking at sub-100 nanometer nanowire regions, if you look at the phase front is remaining nearly constant. It looks like as if this nanowire is not even present. The light is just passing through these nanowires with very little scattering or distortion of the phase front. If you take a cut of these phase fronts, and these three curves have been multiplied by 5 just for ease of visualization, you can see that when the diameter of is about 200 nanometers, there is a phase curvature created, but when we go to sub 100 nanometers, there is hardly any phase curvature created by these nanowires. The phase remains nearly flat of the waveguide, of the optical input path. On the other hand, if I set the magnetic field polarized along the nanowire, then there is a phase distortion happens even at smaller nanometers. This is the reason why PBCs, the photonic band gap crystals, work mainly in the TM mode, not in the TE mode. This is exactly because of the phase front distortions which PBCs allow. So this tells me that if I actually take these nanowires and bring them close together, and if my electric field is polarized along the length of the nanowire, each single nanowire is not scattering light. It's hardly scattering any light. The phase front is really constant. When I bring these nanowires close together, they would start to act like an effective index medium. They would also start to act like a pulse medium, and they should allow light to guide through. And luckily for us, it's the same polarization we need for enhanced optical interaction. It's the same physics which, same physics is basically describing these two properties. The electric field along the length of the nanowires allow me to guide light when I bring these close together. So this behavior is quite different from solid band gap structures, which means that I can probably also disorder these nanowires. I don't need to put them in specific places, and I should still be able to guide light through these nanowires. And this is what we call the silicon nanowire optical waveguide or the slow waveguide. The reason we picked this word snow was the idea we got was in one Canadian winter, we had lots of snow, and then once the snow starts to melt, wherever we have dust, particles will start to create pillar-like structures, and when light shines on it, you see very interesting attractive properties. And one day I and my graduate student were passing through it, because how would it die? Like what would happen with this kind of forest of ice? And the idea for silicon nanowire optical waveguide actually came from that reason. So we thought we'd make it so. So the way this waveguide works is it's on an SOI wafer. This oxide layer provides the vertical confinement. We create these vertical silicon nanowires closely placed together. If the electric field is polarized along the length of the nanowire, they start to act like a very good effective in this medium. They start to guide light to them. I can achieve good optical confinement. We'll show some of the numbers we are achieving theoretically at least. So the vertical confinement is achieved by the distance of the silicon with this oxide layer. The lateral confinement is achieved by placing these nanowires across the This is an FTTD simulation. We take a bulk silicon waveguide, launch it into the slow region, and then launch it into another bulk silicon waveguide. So what we have here is basically we inject light into this bulk silicon region. It gets injected into the slow region. There is an index mismatch which happens between the bulk and the silicon region. So there is a reflectivity which is happening here. The reflectivity is around 10%. And similarly, there is a reflectivity which happens here, so this creates a Fermi ferrocavity. Over many cycles of the FTTD, this Fermi ferrocavity starts to build up, and that's why you see a larger intensity of light within the core region as opposed to the waveguide. We do see some mode mismatch, which is expected, but all this is a slightly lower index compared to the pulse silicon waveguide. We also see some radiation, it's not showing very well in color, but we also see some radiation loss over here. So you can see that there is a small small radiation front coming in this region. That is again expected because there is a mode mismatch between this baseline and this baseline in that region. But this simulation clearly shows, and this simulation has been done over a lot of time. So the light has been made to bounce back and forth at least 30 times between this region. It shows that this region is guiding light quite well. We were also able to come up with a effective index approximation of this region. Here we came up with a weighted index method, which is basically we weight the permittivity of the silicon with the area of silicon and permittivity of the surrounding medium with the area of the surrounding medium. In terms of the indexes, it becomes square root of the weighted index part. And if we take this, and instead of what we did was, instead of launching light into the slope with a bulk silicon waveguide, we launched light with a waveguide which has the same dimensions as the slope region, but now has an index which is equal to the effective index of the slope region. And then we launched that. We see that there is very good matching of the modes between these two regions. There is hardly any radiation happening. The mode shapes are remaining the same. There is no reflection happening at these interfaces. Shows that our effective index approximation is working very well. The advantage of this effective index approximation is that I can use the standard integrated integrated optics formulation to do the design of the slow region. I don't need to do the full FTTD simulation for making or for designing these guides or making structures within that region. This shows the fact of the overlap between the effective index mode and the optical mode as it has propagated through slow. And again, you see a very good overlap showing that the effective index is working quite well. If you see over here, there is a small mismatch, which is expected because there is radiation happening in the slow waveguide. There is some scattering happening by the nanowire, but that radiation pattern can be seen around this region here. If you look at the radiation loss, if you look at the effective index versus different pitches, so for this case, we had a diameter of 50 nanometers and we varied the pitch from 75 nanometers to 250 meters. We see that we look at the overlap integral between the effective index board and the slow board, and we see a very, very high overlap integral greater than 99% over the four regions. We know that the effective index is working over a wide range. If you look at how much of light is confined to the silicon nanowire region, just within the silicon nanowire, we can vary this from around 4% to around 33%, depending on the bit. And we chose the specific values because 50 nanometers and 75 nanometer structures, similar structures on silicon have been built by Caltech, not for wayfinding, for some other solar applications. So this kind of structures have been built before, so it's technologically feasible today. But if I was just doing a 50 nanometer diameter silicon nanowire as a sonic wayfinding, the confinement factor would only be 0.1%. Now I can achieve confinement factor of 33%. In a typical laser quantum well, the confinement factor is between 4 to 5%. So we can achieve the confinement factor required for making optoelectronic devices. And we can alter the confinement factor by playing with the pitch. Firstly, even if I go to smaller diameters, and if I keep the diameter by pitch ratio the same, I can keep the same effective index. If you look at the effective index, it is only dependent upon the ratio of the area of the silicon nanowire with the surrounding medium. If I go to smaller nanowires and place them close together, I should be able to achieve the same optical confinement factor even at smaller diameters. No problem there. If you look at the loss, the radiation loss with the diameter of the nanowire, again we see below 70 nanometers the loss becomes quite low. The 20 nanometer diameter loss is not very accurate because just because the computing state cases, how many grid points could be put within the simulation boundary. And this again mirrors the understanding we had when we looked at only the phase part distortion happening by the nanowire. We have seen that below 70 or 80 nanometers, the phase part was remaining nearly constant, and that is directly related to the scattering loss we are observing here. This directly mirrors that understanding. If you look at the loss versus the pitch, up to around 150 nanometers, roughly, the loss remains low and then it starts to increase efficiency. This was at 1550 nanometer wavelength. This corresponds to roughly lambda by 10. So people had been talking about lambda by 10 approximations in effective index, but nobody had shown this to really work. This is, I believe, is one of the first books which shows that this lambda by 10 when you have the effective index approximations are working quite well from the loss calculation. This is a simulation when in the flow region the nanowires are randomly placed. So the diameter is 50 nanometers, the pitch varies from 0 or from 50 nanometers such that the nanowires are touching to 150 nanometers in a random fashion, completely distributed random fashion, and again we see guiding for light. This is working exactly opposite of how the photonic band gap systems work. This is acting like purely like a metamaterial or an effective index material. The loss in this case is slightly higher than ordered case. For ordered case, the loss was less than 0.2 centimeter inverse. For this case, the loss was around 1.5 centimeter inverse. But it's still possible to make this device. On the other hand, if we send light such that the magnetic field is polarized along the length of the nanowire, we do not see that radiation. So this wavelength has a huge anisotropy depending on how the electric field is polarized. Again, this mirrors the understanding we had from looking at how light travels through the nanowire and how the phase part is distorted depending on the polarization. So this kind of principle can be used to make interesting optical devices like isolators and other cases with these two regions. We can bend these wavelengths. This is a bend of 5 microns. The effective index of this wavelength is approximately 2.2. So the index difference between the pad and the core is quite large in these wavelengths, so you can bend them quite sharply. This is a 5 micron bend. I believe the total radiation loss over a full 360 bend was around 0.15 dB for this case. In this case, the nanowires are uniformly distributed along the bend. We can look at how the loss changes with how the loss changes with Venn radii, axis of curves for the axis of Venn radii, for 5 to 20 microns. And in square region, you actually do not see a monotonic effect, you would see is not the same size. And that is because the square region has a propagation loss because of the when we change the Venn radii, we are also changing the length of the total propagation within the Venn. So they are, so at around this region, the propagation loss is more than the bending loss, and in this region, the bending loss starts to become more important. The propagation loss starts to decrease because the length has decreased, the shear piece will be moved to smaller curves. Again, the effective index works very well over the bend also. So if this is a bend stone, this is an effective index waveside. I just say an effective index waveside. So the effective index approximation is working quite well. The small waveguide also provides us an interesting way to make bends. We can tailor the bends anyway, tailor the waveguide anyway we want it to be. In this case, we wanted to reduce the loss, so what we did is we changed the pitch in the center, in the innermost array to be smaller, and then the pitch on the outermost array to be larger. So what we did was in the row direction, we kept the pitch to be the same. In the phi direction, we changed the pitch from 75 nanometers here to 100 nanometers here. So what effectively this is doing is, I am putting a higher index material here and a lower index material here. In a waveguide bend, what happens is because of the plastic radius, as the light is bending, the mode starts to shift towards the outside, and that leads to radiation loss. Similar to the car turning in a large, in a small curve. The car is going to the outside. Now, by changing the effective index, by changing the index, making the index larger in the center, I can bring the mode backwards. Similar to cycling track, where you put a tilt within the track so that you're not pushed consecutively towards the outside. If we take this, this is the mode shapes now. The red is the mode with respect to the red is the mode with respect to the when they were uniformly distributed. The blue is the mode which has been shifted. This center is the center of the optical waveguide. The sign is the center of the optical waveguide. So you see that in the bend, the mode was shifted towards the outer side. This is the outer side. When we change the effective index, we can push the mode back to the center of the waveguide. And this reduces the loss efficiency. So for same 5 micron, with uniformly distributed waveguides, we had a loss of around 0.15 dB per turn, 360 dB per turn. With this optimized waveguide, the loss is 0.03 dB per 360 dB per turn. This allows us to do this kind of band gap engineering. We have also started to look at fabrication methods for these silicon nanowires. And actually we have tried 3 different methods, but I'll just talk about 2 we have been looking at very carefully. One is a maskless etching method, which we have done, where we just put a silicon wafer in a ledger and we get silicon nanowires on the whole wafer without doing any mask, without doing any critical lithography. And the other one is critical electron beam lithography and dry etching. In the maskless concept, what we do is we etch the silicon with SF6, but we introduce some carbon containing material, typically CF4. Under certain pressure and voltage, this CF4 starts to break up and starts to polymerize on top of the wafer. By changing the pressure and the voltage, we can control this polymerization. So now basically what happens is, at the beginning of the etch, this carbon starts to polymerize into small islands on top of the wafer, and this polymerization diameter can vary from 20 to 100 nanometers, depending on the various etching conditions. And then this carbon cannot be etched by SF6, so it starts to act like a mask for the SF6 etching of the silicon. These are some of the silicon nanowires we have created just by this method. For this specific case, I believe the diameter was 50 nanometers, average diameter was 50 nanometers. The length was 1.7 microns. We can do up to 3 micron length in these nanowires. Diameters we can vary from 20 nanometers to 100 nanometers today. We can control this as thread, almost follow the linear time dependence, so we can control it quite well. The other method we have tried is, we have tried currently is an electron beam lithography based silicon nanowire. In this case, we take a silicon substrate of an FOI wafer. We deposit a hard mask using electron beam lithography system using 2 steps PMMA and then a chrome metal on top to create a mask, and then we etch this using a dry etching. These are the features we are achieving right now. This is up to 70 nanometers in diameter. The pitch so far we have been able to achieve is around 150 nanometers. The diameter, the smallest diameter we have been able to achieve is up to 30 nanometers in this case. And these are some of our initial results of the etching after etching into silicon nanowire. This is just etched by a standard RI process. We are currently following the box etching to create nice polymers.
How much time is it? 10 minutes.
Based on this, I'll conclude the talk. Basically, I hope I've convinced you that silicon nanowires provide really attractive optoelectronic properties, including direct band gap, switching of the band gap, increased optical absorption, non-linearity, which has been observed now. And based on using the source structure, we can achieve the high confinement we can have in standard conventional optical wavefront. So by combining the source structures with this silicon nanowire, we can use these increased optoelectronic properties to actually make devices which should give us better, very good performance. What I did not discuss is that if you look at the core region, the core is kind of a hollow core. So I can start to introduce different materials within the core of the optical mode. Typically, whenever you are trying to do the position of materials on another wavelength, you are always doing it in the MRCP. And typically, you then have to go to high Q structures to make the field, to make the light go many, many times within that region to increase your sensitivity or increase your response. The slow wave time basically consists of nanowires and then it's all hollow around it. So now I can fill it with other materials like bacterial adsorption, for example, or organic polymers or other non-linear materials while achieving the high confinement which silicon provides. This is a very, very high index. This is still a very high index difference which you do not get with standard organic polymers or with bacterial or with other organic molecules. But you still get very high confinement and introduce this material within the core of the region, within the high interaction area of that optical mode. And this should start to make, allow us to make very interesting devices. I did not discuss this, but we can increase the performance of optical nonlinear devices, and we have shown some of that work. By using this low region, we can make optical logic gates, and we can increase the optical power required for switching by using this slow wave type. And that concludes my talk. Thank you so much for the question.